Hello 3D printing friends, today on the BV3D channel we'll get a look at the FLSun Super Racer. Stick around and we'll get into it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. Hi, welcome back. Hey, if you're new here and you're wanting to learn about 3D printing, 3D modeling, and other 3D printing related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Okay, so today we're taking a look at the Super Racer, which FLSun was kind enough to send over. The Super Racer is FLSun's newest Delta 3D printer. Now, my friend Garret over at 3D Print Farm recently had a video about this printer as well, where he printed a huge dice tower with it. And every time he said Super Racer, he seemed to be putting all the emphasis on the first syllable of super. And all I could hear was,
Super Racer.
Super Racer.
A Super Racer.
Super Racer.
Okay, so back to the printer. FLSun says its default printing speed is 150 millimeters per second. And it's a huge tower of a printer, standing about a meter tall with a spool of filament on board. It has a filament runout sensor. It has a BMG-style geared extruder pushing filament through a Bowden tube to a PTFE-lined volcano-style hot end with a 0.4 millimeter nozzle. You can set the nozzle up to 255 degrees Celsius, but I don't recommend going past about 235 degrees. At temperatures above that, the PTFE liner can start to degrade. It has a 260 millimeter diameter bed, which can get up to 100 degrees Celsius, and a build height of 330 millimeters. It's got silent stepper motor drivers, a detachable bed probe, and a seriously nice wired touchscreen that attaches magnetically to a bracket on the frame. That lets you grab the screen, interact with the printer, and then put the screen back in place. The three axes have linear rails, 10 millimeter belts, and high torque stepper motors. The parallel arms connecting these to the end effector are carbon fiber with strong springs keeping them in place. And it comes with the usual assortment of extras. Flush cutters, a scraper, a microSD card and USB card reader, screwdriver, Allen wrenches, a nozzle wrench, a tube of grease to keep things lubed, and an acupuncture needle for use in the event of a nozzle clog. There is also a brush for keeping the printer dust-free. And it came with an absolutely adorable 200-gram spool of filament. It looks like a scale model of a regular spool. In addition to all that, though, FLSun gives you a set of spare hot-end parts. The heater block, nozzle, heat break, nozzle heater cartridge, and thermistor. And finally, it's got a handy drawer on the front for keeping all those tools in one place. Okay, so putting the Super Racer together is easy. The included manual shows the assembly steps. The short version is that you bolt the three axes to the top shell of the printer, then bolt the bottom shell on, attach the end effector with the parallel arms, bolt on the extruder, and plug in the cables. I would estimate you're looking at maybe 30 minutes from unboxing to done. If you're more of a visual person than a read-the-manual person, the microSD card contains a text file with links to FLSun's YouTube videos. The videos cover assembly and troubleshooting, and using the touchscreen for leveling, filament loading and unloading, and printing. Speaking of the touchscreen, it's easy to use. The screen is attached to the printer with a curly cord and is held in place magnetically. You can adjust the position and angle of the magnetic mount to put the screen where you want it within range of the cord. Some other printer screens have weird contrast issues when not viewed straight on, but this one is viewable from pretty much any angle. And it uses a capacitive touch sensor instead of a clear plastic overlay. Overall, the screen behaves like the screen on a smartphone. However, like a lot of touch-based user interfaces, this one tries to hide a lot of the complexity of a 3D printer. For the most part, I guess that's okay. The things you need on a constant basis are there. A print button lets you select files from the microSD card for printing. A tools button lets you set nozzle and bed temperature, and a keypad is displayed so you can just type in the temperature you need. You can also load and unload filament, move the end effector around, and probe the bed in a process called auto-leveling, which doesn't level anything but instead senses the level of the bed. Leveling is just one of those terms we have to deal with in 3D printing. But if you're used to being able to dig down through the menus to set jerk and acceleration values or adjust the steps per millimeter on the extruder, you'll be disappointed. For that kind of work, you'll need to temporarily tether the printer to a computer running Prontoface or connect it to a Raspberry Pi running Octoprint, because you'll need to type G-code commands directly to the printer to set those kinds of values and to save them to the printer's memory. And while that's more of an intermediate level thing and not necessarily a beginner level thing, I've seen other printers that allow you to directly enter G-code commands from the screen, and I think that sort of thing might be handy to have on this printer. So one of the things that comes on the microSD card is a recent-ish version of Cura. The card I got came with version 4.4. And it's semi-customized, containing only FLSun printers and a pair of FLSun-provided printer profiles for the Super Racer. One profile is named Fast, and one is named Fine. The problem, at least for me, is that the included 4.4 version of Cura is Windows only. They don't include a customized Cura for Mac or Linux computers. So I downloaded the current version of Cura, 4.12.1, and installed that on my Mac. Conveniently, it includes printer settings for the FLSun printers, including the Super Racer. And it includes two printing profiles, Normal, which slices with 0.2mm layers, and Fine, which slices with 0.12mm layers. So I sliced and printed two XYZ cubes. This is Normal. This is Fine. The Normal one, Cura said it would take only 13 minutes. In reality, it took 19 minutes. Still, that's pretty dang fast for an XYZ cube. Printing this on an Ender 3 would typically take 35 or 40 minutes with my usual settings. But it's a little rough around the edges. There is a bulge on the corner at the left side of each face. There's a bit of a gap along the top fill where it meets the face at the left side of the Z, and there's a gap at the bottom of the Z. Now, this is the Fine one. Cura said this would take 26 minutes to print, but it took 33 minutes. Again, still about twice as fast as if I printed with 0.12mm layer heights on an Ender 3. This one looks much better compared to the Normal one. The faces look a lot better, the corners don't bulge, and the Z face doesn't have that slight gap at the left where it meets that wall. But it does still have that gapping at the bottom of the Z itself. So I also sliced some calicats using both the Normal and Fine profiles. With the Normal profile, with 0.2mm layers, I got this result in 28 minutes instead of about an hour. It's actually not too bad for an under 30-minute calicat. No major issues, though there's a bit of a pattern to the surface finish. The tail doesn't show any cooling-related issues on the 45-degree overhang, so that's good. With the Fine profile, with 0.12mm layers, I got this result in 51 minutes. Surface finish-wise, it looks a lot better. Like, it looks really good, and this would easily take an hour and a half with my usual settings for an Ender 3. Looking at some other test prints, I can get some remarkably string-free retraction slash stringing tests out of it. And here's Luby3D's Aria Dragon on Normal. She took an hour and 38 minutes to print, which is a full hour faster than the 3 hours 15 minutes I'm used to. And here's Aria on Fine after just under 3 hours on the printer instead of the 5 plus hours I would have expected. Now, both the Normal one and the Fine one have some stringing in between the wings. And while the Normal one has the occasional bump on the skin, the Fine one came out, fine. It's nice and smooth, except where the strings are happening, in between the wings. Now, the stringing was kind of unexpected, given the stringing test model I showed a minute ago, but apart from that, they both seem to have come out pretty good, and I don't see other major problems with it. And it can knock out a Benchy pretty quickly, at 57 minutes for Normal instead of the 1 hour 45 minutes I usually wait. That said, at the Normal speed, this Benchy has a few issues. It's got a bit of a lumpy license plate at the back, and the filament was curling up a bit on the bow as it was being printed. This issue on the bow is almost always related to insufficient cooling. Beyond that, though, the Benchy looks okay. So the Super Racer is a pretty fast, capable printer, and I know part of that comes from what the slicer is telling it to do, but the other part is its ability to actually carry out those instructions. Now, I'm mostly a Prusa slicer user, and I don't spend a lot of time in Cura, so So I'm sure there are tons of tweaks and settings that can be adjusted to improve the print quality on Cura's Super Racer profiles while maintaining the speed. In fact, if you've got a Super Racer and you'd be willing to share some tips with everyone, particularly for enabling a no-strings relationship with printed models, put those down in the comments so we can all benefit. Oh, one last print here. I scaled up Aria to 300 millimeters tall and printed her with the normal profile. She took about 12 hours and 45 minutes to print. And one thing I gotta say about Delta printers, they make for good time lapses without a lot of effort. And this big Aria, she came out pretty good too. Okay, now that we've seen some of the output, here's what I like about the Super Racer. So yeah, the obvious thing is that it's fast. In some instances, it can churn out a print twice as fast as I tend to get with my other printers. It seems sturdy and well-designed, and it's pretty easy to assemble with just a handful of steps. And that touchscreen is nice. The user interface is easy to operate, but some intermediate to advanced settings are missing. I like being able to pull it off the front of the printer to either check the progress of a print, or change a setting midstream, or load or unload filament. Parts cooling seemed to be mostly sufficient for what I was printing, although in some instances the speed of the printer was overwhelming its ability to cool one layer well enough before the next one was laid down, like on the bow of that Benchy. It's not fall asleep next to it quiet, but apart from some fan noise, it's quieter than a lot of 3D printers. The power supply fan seems to be the loudest one on the machine. So now here are a few of the things I didn't like about the Super Racer. I had fast in the likes category, but I think there are some instances where it can be a little too fast for the filament I used with it. You can run the nozzle hotter to kind of compensate for that, but that can introduce other issues like stringing or blobs on a print. As with any 3D printer, you have to find a balance between speed and good enough output, and so you may find yourself spending time tuning slicer settings to get where you want to be. The positioning of the micro SD card slot is a little awkward since it's around the back of the printer, and you need to have eyes on it to make sure you're putting the card in the right way. It might be easier to plug a flash drive into the USB port in order to print, but you have to flash the firmware to switch from using the micro SD card to using the USB port. Like there are literally two versions of the firmware, one that uses the micro SD card slot and one that uses the USB port. To be fair, it's not difficult to do, and FLSun does include both firmware files on the card, but it's kind of cumbersome. In contrast, my Artillery Sidewinder X1 has a setting to switch between using the USB port and the micro SD card. Before assembly, I checked the high current wiring on the mainboard. These are the ones clamped into the screw terminals. The power inputs had connectors crimped onto them, but the output wires for the nozzle's heater cartridge were tinned with solder. The heat sink's fan wires were right next to it and also tinned. So I snipped off the tinned ends, stripped off some insulation, and crimped on some ferrules. The fan really didn't need these, but I figured as long as I had the tools out, I'd do those as well. Sometimes I feel like I just keep going on and on about why the high current connections in 3D printers need to have ferrules on them when they're used with these screw terminal blocks. But I'm going to continue bringing it up when I run into it because from what I can tell, it's safer than having the ends of the wires tinned with solder. Well, anyway, that was a lot of words, but there's really not much to dislike about the Super Racer. It towers over all the other printers in my collection. Big thanks to FLSun for sending this over so we could get a look at it. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this episode. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool. And fast. Hey, real quick before you go, I wanted to say thanks for being one of the super awesome people who sticks around all the way to the end, and thanks for all the likes, comments, and shares. And an especially big thanks to those who directly support what I do. You're all wonderful for doing that, and I really appreciate it. If you liked this episode, a thumbs up would be great, and if you'd like to help support the channel, check the description for ways you can do exactly that. And hey, if you haven't already subscribed, please do. It's absolutely free, and it's an excellent way to help keep me making these videos for you. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time here on the BV3D channel.